Good morning, everyone. Just want to say thank you very much for being here, and hello to those folks that are joining us online via the web format. It's great to be able to be here. You'll see my beautiful wife, Stephanie, here in just a minute. She'll be doing her introduction after I do mine. But before we do any of that, we just want to start with a basic question to just kind of get everybody, I guess, in the right mindset for what we're preparing to do here over the next 3 days, which is kind of get our mind around the dimensions of sex trafficking, one of the most prolific and violent forms of human exploitation that exists in the world today, and then take that understanding and talk about how we apply that in a clinical setting and how to treat it. What are some tips? What are things we've learned? What are the models and the research? What do they show about what's currently going on internationally and domestically on how to treat this? And then what are ways to interact with victims? What can you expect from victims? What treatment concerns are they going to come in with? What are their presenting symptoms going to be, and where do clinicians tend to sometimes get stuck? Our goal is to help navigate all that, and we're doing it in 3 days, so we got a lot of material to cover in a short period of time. There is a place, obviously, online where questions can be posted. We'll try to get to those during the break and look them over. We may bring them up periodically as we move through section to section. Obviously, for those of you that are here, if you have questions, please ask them. We will say, obviously, we hope to keep them short if we can, right? In the interest of time, because we do have a massive amount of information to get through. But we also, if there's something that we say that's confusing or you have a question or need, want us to elaborate on something, we definitely want to give you what you came here for, which is to walk away with a complete and total understanding and just, you know, and to just feel like this was very worthwhile for you in whatever capacity you're functioning in and helping these victims. So also hats off to you for that, for being here, number one, taking the time, but also for the work that you do individually. So let me start with a question. And the question is this: how many of you, first and foremost, direct access to trafficking victims and work with them on a regular basis? Gonna see a show of hands, okay? The rest of you are here to learn about working with this population, is that correct? Okay, awesome.
Not on a regular basis.
But occasionally, right? Okay, and that's typically the way it works, because there are very few agencies that are getting a large stream of victims coming in. It's something that's going to show up in maybe some aspect of the work that you do. And it, when it does show up, it's one of those things where sometimes we feel unprepared to handle it, and or we want more information just to figure out how to deal with the dimensions of it and how to refer for services. So my question is this: those of you who have had the experience of actively working with someone who is coming out of human trafficking, what is the one characteristic about them that stands out in your mind? Dissociation, okay? Anyone else? The one characteristic that you would say you observe, it doesn't have to be the defining characteristic, but the one that you say is very prevalent.
Traumatized,
correct. Anything else? How about behavioral or a personal characteristic, the way they view the world even, anything in that regard?
Mistrustful, guarded, and shut down,
okay? Goes a lot with trauma and dissociation, right? Some of those expected manifestations of that. Anyone else?
Anxiety.
Big one, yeah. Anxiety in a lot of different areas, for sure. Okay, fantastic, very good. Okay, so my name's Brian Simmons. A little bit about me, my history. So I, prior to getting into the mental health field, I was a law enforcement officer for 15 years. Started with the city of Dallas, spent about 3.5 years there before I moved to the Kaufman County Sheriff's Office. When I left that agency, I left as a lieutenant, spent the majority of my career on the streets. As a supervisor, I was a mental health peace officer, I was a hostage negotiator, a field training officer, and a certified SWAT officer as well. So I had a lot of experience just working in a lot of different areas with individuals struggling with different degrees and dimensions of mental illness. Made the transition, got into counseling, something I never thought I would do. But surprisingly enough, the history in law enforcement was a great segue into kind of having a lot of experience quickly about people in different degrees of distress, different degrees of crisis, and in different situations. Now I work in trauma with my wife, and we're both traumatologists. I've got my bachelor's from Southern Methodist University in political science and history. I got my master's from Amberton University, and I'm an EMDR provider, a certified hypnotist, and like I said, work with all degrees of traumatization. That is what I specialize in. Of course, when you're in private practice, you're also eclectic. I have, for the last 3 years, I've worked with an organization by the name of Valiant Hearts, which is a Christian nonprofit that helps women coming out of the sex industry and also helps sex trafficking victims. I spent a year working as a treatment provider for them, and then spent another year working as clinical director for their organization. So, and now, again, I'm pretty much primarily in private practice, and my wife and I are working with an organization now called EMI, and which does a lot of work in Iraq right now. And she and I have both made several trips to Iraq to work to begin a trauma program over there to help men and women that have been brutalized by ISIS. So, men, women, and children that have been brutalized by ISIS. So, anyway, so a lot going on there in the sex trafficking world for us as far as trying to make an impact on a global scale. So I'm going to hand it over to Stephanie. I'm going to let her do her introduction, and then she's got a couple questions she'd like to ask you as well.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I've been struggling with the head cold for a couple weeks now, so forgive me if I start hacking in your face today. How many of you are mental health professionals here today? Okay, quite a bit. Day three will mostly be for you. How many of you work in agencies that do well-rounded services for trafficking victims? Okay. Anybody in the rescue part? We've got rescue and restoration. Anybody in the rescue area? Okay. So everybody here is restoration. Let's heal them when they're rescued. Anybody in law enforcement? Okay. Attorneys. Or anybody in the healthcare field? Who else am I missing?
Department of Child Safety.
Ah, okay. DPS, Child Protective Services, Adult Services. Great, okay. How many of you are in state agencies, state-funded agencies? Okay. How many of you are in private sector, private practice? Okay, great. Kind of gives us a feel to how to slay at some of this. Would you guys say you primarily are looking for basic information on trafficking, the inner workings of how trafficking occurs, or the mental health restoration healing process? How many of you need all of it, actually? Okay. This is a really intensive 3-day training. Just about every section in this 3-day training could be a 3-day workshop in and of itself. And by the end of the training, our goal is to have you completely overwhelmed and realize what you didn't know. And if any time there's some things you need more resources or information references on, just ask us, because there's no way we can cover a whole lot of this that's actually in the PowerPoint. They're in your handouts. We're going to get blaze through quite a bit of this for time, but stop us on a break or shoot us an email. We'll put our emails up on the board, and we'll get you further information if you need. This basically has to be in the PowerPoint, and this slide says if you are a mental health or service provider, you need to get further training in this. This is not going to qualify you to do everything you want to do. That's just the disclaimer. Learning objectives you have in your handouts. It's going to be very well-rounded. Today we're going to primarily focus on what trafficking is, statistics, rules and laws and regulations, as well as go quite a bit into the trafficking world, the types of traffickers, and how their organizations function. What we're going to do today is give you the foundation and the principles with working with victims. If you understand the organized crime behind it, you understand what the laws and the regulations are that go with it, you will be able to understand day two and day three. Day two is talking about the Johns themselves, the customers, and the sexual abuse victims, and why we consider prostitution a trafficking victim. We're trying to change the dominant discourse in our culture, as well as internationally, and how we view victims. Also, the trauma piece will kick in towards the end of the day. And then day three is primarily going to be for treatment. So the learning objectives is going to be a well-rounded And then we'll go through the problems. So like my husband and I said, we are from Texas in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. We're in private practice. We have a well-rounded practice, but we do it primarily trauma. Trauma spectrum, you name it, it comes in. We work with trafficking victims, and he works with more trafficking victims than I do. I work with the offenders. I've worked with sex offenders through the courts for about 20 years now, as well as federal. I've worked on state level, felony misdemeanor cases, sex addiction, pornography. And we have a well-rounded range of clients, from teenagers that have behavior modification issues to divorce prep, marriage and family, to eating disorders, to self-injury, to anything trauma spectrum, to I hate my husband and my kid's a brat, you know, and people just want to find themselves. We have lots of that too. So a lot of our experience will come from well-rounded practice, but we'll focus primarily on the trauma spectrum. I have a bachelor's in human development family studies. My master's is in professional counseling, emphasis on family therapy and play therapy. And my PhD is in family therapy. So I'm technically a family therapist, not a psychologist. But he and I share the same trainings. We're both EMDR providers. Who in here knows what EMDR is? Okay, oh great, okay. Starting to get, how many of you are trained in it and provide it? Okay, that's good. It's starting to really spread throughout the country. It's our favorite treatment modality for trauma, which we'll go into on day three a little bit, but there's quite a few treatment options for trauma out there. Certified hypnotherapist. We are both certified in EFT or tapping. If you don't know what that is, we'll go through that on day three too. That's great. Which is basically acupressure, really. I don't know, we have so many certifications, it's not worth it after a while, you know. But I'm also a licensed sex offender treatment provider, licensed deregistration specialist for Texas. And this training comes not just from our trafficking work, but also through his experience being law enforcement, working with SWAT as well as the Sheriff's Department in the DFW area. My work in residential treatment facilities, outpatient clinics, psych hospitals, you name it. So anything private sector and state agency oriented, we've encountered it. So if you have any questions on how to apply some of this trafficking information to your organization, let us know, because the politics can be really tricky. We've been there, done that, domestically and internationally. Okay, so what is the problem? So how many of you have heard that trafficking is considered the modern day form of slavery? Anytime you hear trafficking, you should always hear the modern day form of slavery attached to it. And that's a huge concept. When you go out into your community and you repeat this information you're learning the next 3 days, that's an important concept for you to be teaching people, that it's not a matter of choice, that it is not a metaphor or euphemism for slavery. It is in fact legal definition of slavery. We're going to go through what the legal definitions are. You will see recruiting, harboring, transporting, providing, or obtaining throughout this PowerPoint. You're also going to see forced fraud or coercion throughout this PowerPoint. Those are the concepts that are in both the international and the domestic laws that designate what human trafficking is. Sex trafficking is just one component of human trafficking. It's the one we're going to focus on in this training. But that definition, those are the words that you will always see. It also might be in some certification quizzes at the end of the training, which you have in your hand now. So overall, I'm going to try not to read directly from the PowerPoint the whole time, but forgive me if I do a little bit. So there's different forms of trafficking. You have labor, you have domestic servitude, you have sex trafficking, you have organ trafficking, you name it. Anytime that you are selling people for goods or services is considered a form of trafficking. And the difficulty with the statistics with sex trafficking is sometimes these victims fall in more than one category of trafficking. So when we're looking at the research and the statistics, they're going to be a little skewed, because the way they've got the definitions for the different forms of trafficking, they're not accounting for that person that might also be, say, domestic servitude, where they are forced to work in someone's house, say as a house servant, but they're also forced to perform sexual acts as well. They'll fit in two different forms of trafficking, but they're not necessarily hitting the statistics. So when you look at the statistics, know that the numbers are inherently going to be low. It's also very underestimated. Victims typically are not identified. So when you're looking at statistics, especially if you just Google statistics, it is really difficult to find statistics. I don't know if any of you have actually done it. You'll find it, Polaris is fantastic. You'll find some of the basic websites that organizations that will do domestic and international studies that are legitimate, and they're also funded by the government sometimes. Even their statistics will be incongruent with one another. It has a lot to do with the problems with research that we'll briefly go through today. Human trafficking is not what we typically think of. You know, the Liam Neeson movies where they snatch you and throw you on a plane and take you somewhere to Europe. That certainly does happen, and we certainly encounter that. But they're also right here under our noses. In our neighborhood, we work in a very affluent area, and I can get in my car, and within 5 to 7 minutes, I can locate 5 different trafficking places that are being hidden just in storefronts. You know, he probably knows where more of them are. They're everywhere, but people don't know what they're looking for. And oftentimes, if we're in just a restaurant, there's going to be trafficking victims in the back, but we're not going to know that. There is a direct connection between the commercial sex trade and sex trafficking. Absolute direct, as well as pornography. Pornography drives sex trafficking. We'll go through that later on this afternoon. Trafficking is an organized crime. Even if you're looking at what we call the small-time Romeo pimps here in America, or you're looking at the mafioso, it is organized, it is structured, it's run like a business. Different people have different roles. There's not just one trafficker pushing a bunch of victims. There's an entire network of people called facilitators that we'll discuss later that work together to have trafficking occur. If you look at the laws, which we'll go through here in a little bit, there is sadly very little attention paid to human trafficking overall. Now it is growing, which is very nice to see. The last few years we've seen growing attention. A lot of that honestly has to do with some laws that Obama put into place primarily, which affects U.S. funding for other countries. If they violate our trafficking statutes, then we withhold their money if they're contractors or subcontractors with government funding. And it's also luckily becoming something that people are taking seriously. But there's a lot of countries that form a big amount of profit off of trafficking, and it's not within their financial best efforts to even care. Or they might not have the resources. When we go to Iraq, the government cares immensely about the trafficking victims. They know where they're being held in the local brothels. We're talking about children up to adults, but they don't have the resources to do that. If they rescue them, which they know where they are, they have nowhere to put them. So you're gonna rescue hundreds upon thousands of trafficking victims and put them where? And who's going to help them? They start self-destructing. We know when you work with victims that the stabilization process is not just a couple of days or a few weeks. It's 2.5 to 5 years on average just to stabilize them, if not longer. And it's not just breathing techniques. There's an entire process to stabilization. And you have to have educated, funded would be nice, organizations that are equipped and prepared to deal with the stabilization process. A lot of these countries don't have the resources, they don't have the funding, they don't have the providers, and they don't have the education either. But internationally, you're primarily going to see America and Europe that are the forerunners in trafficking, as well as those that have the legal definitions. and the laws too. One of the problems with our culture here in America is we tend to think that females and children are victims. The males are grossly underestimated. There's an immense amount of males that are trafficking victims, and they're being overlooked, they're being ignored. In fact, when there are social services here in America, many times the males are not part of what qualify for the services. You will get the women that get services, the services that are available for funding. Funding is incredibly limited. You guys know that more than anybody else. But the males coming in oftentimes don't qualify for the definitions, even to get into housing, you know, and the education and the job placement. There is hardly ever trauma treatment that goes with that. We're just looking at their basic needs. So that's something that is starting to get noticed, and it's a good thing, but it's still very underestimated. Here in America, we think prostitution is a victimless crime. We arrest them. We'll go through the different models on different countries on how they view legalization of prostitution. Who do you arrest? Who do you prosecute? Do you legalize it? Does it help? We'll go through that in a little bit. But here in America, we arrest the supply and we arrest the demand. We arrest the Johns, we arrest the traffickers, and we arrest the victims. The traffickers are incredibly difficult to identify and incredibly difficult to prosecute. It's very expensive to prosecute a trafficker. They tend to be very hidden and underground. There's an entire network that's difficult to identify. They're very good at staying anonymous. When we do prosecute them in America, it's huge. It's a big deal. And oftentimes a big organization can go down. But we typically, when we arrest the Johns or the consumers, the customers of trafficking, it's a slap on the wrist. Where we live in Texas, it's a Class C misdemeanor. It's like loitering. It's like I just threw my trash out of the car. They'll get a fine, maybe a little bit of community service, and they go back out on the streets. When this population tends to be incredibly compulsive, they are repeat customers, and they are driving the supply. If we don't have the demand, we wouldn't have the need for supply. But what we are doing primarily in America is arresting the victims, because we view prostitution as a crime and we view it as a voluntary operation. We'll go through here in a little bit with statistics. And again, the statistics are very small. We don't know a whole lot. We don't have a lot of research on them. But what we do have, 90% of prostitution are trafficking victims. That's a staggering number. Now, what's the other 10%? They're called renegades. And renegades are prostitutes who have broken free from their pent, and they are now self-marketing. Now, if they broke away from their pimp and now they are solo practice, they were at one time with a pimp. Would that not technically mean we have 100% of prostitution being trafficking victims? I would say so, absolutely. And if we can change the attitude in our culture that victims, that prostitutes do it by choice, we will go a long way in helping trafficking victims. And part of the training is to explain that, primarily tomorrow. Okay, so the main thing to know in trafficking victims in America, now we do have those that come from a source country where they live, and they're flown or taken to what's called a destination country like America. There are some countries that are the top destination countries, and America is one of those. They're going to be the affluent countries, the ones that have well-educated, primarily males, who can pay for the trafficking victims, and America is one of those. So they do get kidnapped, and they do travel here. However, the prostitutes on the streets, these are Americans, and they're right under our noses. But we will prosecute them, which is re-victimizing them. Instead of seeing them as victims who need services, we're making them criminals. They go through the criminal system. Now they have a criminal record. when they get a criminal record, now they can't get a job, they can't get education, they can't loans, they can't get loans, they can't get funding. It affects them from being able to better their life. So what are they forced to do? Right back where they were. And it's a self-defeating system that we have, the way that we're treating these victims. That is changing. I know in Arizona it's changing. It's starting to change in our area. Tarrant County is where we work, which is the Fort Worth area. And we live in Denton County. If you look at kind of, you've got Fort Worth area, you've got Denton County, and then you've got Dallas County. And that entire sector right there is really starting to change, where the police officers are arresting prostitutes, but they will question them and interview them through what's called a trauma-informed model. And if you don't know trauma-informed or TIC, then we're gonna go through it briefly on day three. And they're starting to give them services instead of sending them right to jail, and it's really great to see. There's a huge push in our state of Texas. Our attorney general has a huge push and works with the president to change the trafficking laws and how we treat the victims. And I know that Arizona, you guys are doing that actually better than Texas does, and you always have. But if we change the discrimination and the stigmatization of prostitution here in America and take more of a victim model instead of a criminal model, then we're going to go a long way. In your appendix that aren't in the PowerPoint, there's tons of definitions that are just good for you guys to know, particularly if you're working directly with the victims. The more you know about the culture that they've been through, the more you know the terminology they use, then you'll be able to interact with them and connect with them on a better level, especially if you're providing direct therapy services and where you're needing to build that rapport. If they feel like you get them, then you're going to go a long way with the bonding and attachment and being able to help them. A lot of these victims, you know, they're from the street and they're hardened and they're tough and they have a particular vernacular and they have a particular way they carry themselves, and a lot of them have been criminalized. And if they come into your office and they look at all of your degrees, they look at your, you know, your painted fingernails and your pretty things, they're gonna think, eh, you know what you're doing. They're gonna completely discredit you just on view alone, if they're even lucky enough to get into therapy. Assuming they even know they're trafficking victims, because a lot of them don't recognize that, which we'll discuss later. But with this training, if you start to understand the culture that they came from, the victimizations they've been through, how they've been treated, and the way that they've basically been criminalized, then you'll be able to talk about those things and have relatability, and you'll get street cred with them immediately. It is so important to get street cred with these victims. I mean, within the first 5 minutes, they've already sized you up before you've even said anything. When they walk in your office, they've already sized the whole thing up. And they are masters at assessing their environment. They've had to survive. They're masters at ignoring what you say, but looking at your nonverbals, looking at the environment, because it's kill or be killed where they are. And part of that trauma reactivity that we'll talk about from a neurophysiological perspective, how the brain and the body and the central nervous system wires the stuff in, is they're reacting to the environment before you've even said your name. And it's based on trauma memory networks, and they're usually pretty right. So if you're not comfortable working with a victim, they're gonna smell it on you. Mm-hmm. You know? So these three terms are probably the most three important terminology to know, because if you're gonna ever testify in court, or if you're gonna write a report, these are the proper terms to use. For example, CSEM, child sexual exploitation material, is the new proper academic term for child pornography. So you can use child porn or child pornography in your normal vernacular, but if you're ever speaking in a professional way, you want to say CSEM, or child sexual exploitation material. The reason why that is it broadened the definition of child pornography. There's a difference in child pornography and child erotica. We've got it in here, or maybe in the addendum, I can't remember. But there is a difference, and If you're going to prosecute someone for CSEM, you've got to separate child erotica from child pornography, and it can be very subtle what can be prosecuted and what can't. But child pornography was too limited in scope. You have a lot of things that are not considered typical pornography, such as hentai. Who knows what hentai is? Or anime. Some of your Japanese or your Asian cartoons called anime. Hentai is a pornographic form of anime. And it's geared towards children. And oftentimes it's a soft form of child pornography because it typically is based on childlike characters. So they had to broaden the exploitation material, because what are you going to do if you have an erotic story format that's describing in detail sexual abuse of a child or sexualizing a child's body? You know, could it be prosecutable? So they have broadened the definition and scope to CSEN, so it's not just the videos and the pictures that we typically think of. DMST, domestic minor sex trafficking, you'll see that a lot. That is an American term. You'll see it in the literature. It's focusing on minors that are being trafficked, because minors have, although there are some similarities with adults, minors in particular have different characteristics and different elements to their trauma that the adults don't have due to their developmental levels. Any of you work with minors? Okay, then you know what I'm talking about. It's different than adults. Good. And then CSE, commercial sexual exploitation, that's just the general concept for any time a sex act is performed for exchange of bills or goods and services. So when you are looking at the literature, you'll see those concepts a lot. Okay, we'll go through this really briefly. Trafficking in persons and human trafficking, those are interchangeable terms. They mean the same thing. You do not have to travel across country to be trafficked. You don't have to travel across continents to be trafficked. You can be trafficked in your neighborhood. Here in America, there is a movement of trafficking where they're coming into affluent suburban neighborhoods, trafficking the rich kids. We're seeing it where we live. Why is that? Because they are really easy to groom and manipulate. They're naive. They haven't had a rough life, typically. They love bling. It's easy to groom them with pot, beer, and cars. And they're going into the high schools, they're planting other kids to befriend them, and then they will come over that kid's house, hang out, play video games, whatever, and then here comes Uncle So-and-so, or here comes their mom, and now you've got human trafficking right under our noses. Okay, the consent, we're going to go through that on another slide, pretty in depth. It's important to know that minors can never consent. I don't care what they tell you. I don't care what Dr. Phil says. They cannot consent. Based on age laws in our country, every state has their own age laws that legally define when somebody can truly consent to any kind of sex whatsoever. We're going to go through that in more depth in a minute. But any minor under the age of 18 can't consent. They don't know what they're doing. The frontal lobe, this part of the brain, is important for impulse control. It doesn't even fully develop between 24 and 26 years old. And they're thinking that's not even accurate. And males develop slower than females. We females know this. They can't consent to sex. We're barely able to do it at our age. You know, they can't do it as kids. Trafficking and smuggling are different. Smuggling, the person that is being smuggled signed up for it. They know what's encountered. They might not know the deplorable conditions that they encounter once they are being smuggled. They might not know the manipulation that occurred to take their money and not get them to their destination. They might not realize the torture that they're going to go through. But they know that once they arrive at their destination, it's over. There's also exchange of money for the purpose of transportation. When you're trafficked, totally different. They didn't volunteer for anything. If they sign up for something, it was under false pretenses, which we'll go through. They were manipulated into thinking that they were going to get a job or they're going to be a model or something. And is completely coerced and manipulated, and it's totally against their will. And once they arrive at their destination, it just began. Okay, so statistics. Again, barriers to statistics, we're talking about problems with research. We know enough to be dangerous right now, but victims and traffickers aren't going to identify themselves. No trafficker is going to say, here I am, ask me anything you want to know. They're hiding. Johns aren't going to do that. A lot of the research we have is based on prostitutes that have been arrested and or they're in treatment facilities and they're being interviewed for research, and it's based on their perceptions. But we don't really have full access to the actual traffickers or to Johns. So what we do know is certainly valuable and helpful, and it seems to be very standardized. They're not deviating from the descriptions when you ask the prostitutes, but that's a tiny percentage, right? Roughly 99% of the research we have on Johns or the consumers are from the prostitutes, from the victims themselves. So we don't really know what's going on with the Johns in their minds. The research that is tight is in the sex offender realm. And the sex offender treatment protocol and the research is extensive, and the Johns are still being pretty neglected in the sex offender research, because Johns typically seem to be low-level sex offenders. But they are the ones that are driving the trafficking industry. So we have to have this merging of these two worlds. If we would combine those resources, it would be amazing. I've been a licensed sex offender for a long time, worked, but I can't take conferences for maybe 18, 19 years. And last year, 2 years ago, was the first time I've seen trafficking even mentioned at the national level. ATSA is the APA for sex offender licensing. We're going to go to Vancouver next month for the national level conference of 3 days. Tons of plenaries every day for 3 days. There's 1 hour and a half on trafficking. I'm talking an international, highly renowned conference where people are flying in from everywhere in the world to work with sex offenders, not getting trained on trafficking. It enrages me. So we have a long way to go with research. So when you see a statistic, keep that in mind. It's probably really, really lowballed. Okay, moving on. Okay, so what statistics do we have? 40 million in modern slavery worldwide. 15 million are into forced marriages. Forced marriages could also be one of those victims that would also fall into sex trafficking. But we've got them in the forced marriage statistic right there. 71% are women or girls. Is that accurate or not? Hard to tell. We know that males are not being identified. It's not just in America. They're overseas as well. Or is that an accurate representation? We don't know. The child statistics are also not accurate, because a lot of your child pornography, the overwhelming majority of child pornography is done on victims that are 2 years old and younger. Reason for that being is they can't talk. And they're not going to self-identify, so the child trafficking and child pornography statistics are grossly underrated. Okay, so traffickers don't have a very high risk for being arrested. They don't have a high risk for being identified. They're able to hide. In other countries in particular, there are indeed corrupt police. There are corrupt law enforcement, there's corrupt governments that are working with the traffickers, and it's highly lucrative for them. It's not within their best interest to care at all. And then we're talking about culture. Some other countries, they don't really care about the women and the children. They are still property, they're still commodities. They don't have the progression that we do here in the States. So when you try to go to another country and work with trafficking victims, the males aren't going to care. They don't get what the big deal is. They're property anyways. They're commodities. And you're messing with their commodity. And if you go into another country as a female, for example, to work with another female population, you're going to have to encounter the male attitude as well. We're not used to that in America much. Now, we certainly whine and cry about how there's discrimination against women, and there certainly still is until you go over to the Middle East. And then you realize how nice we have it here, as well as plumbing and soap that actually has bubbles. That's nice too. But it's really difficult to go to another country where they don't really care. And they might care about the women, but it's a woman's thing, you know? And that's even changing in Kurdistan as well, with the good guys in Iraq.
Yeah, Iraq lowered the marriage age to 10. Right?
Yeah, they did. You want to tell them why?
No. You can tell them. So, they've been debating it for a long time. There's been a push. It was higher. But there's always that part of the population that wants to lower it, you know? So to a lower age. So it's been going back and forth for years in that particular country.
And ISIS parallels that. They manipulate the Muslim religion to be able to marry. They will marry to have sex in their religion. So they'll just marry whomever they just kidnapped. And if they're 10, okie dokie, they will marry them. They will have sex with them multiple times. Maybe for a day or two, maybe for months, divorce them, sell them to another guy, does it in 10 minutes, on and on and on, which he'll go into further. But you will have a victim in the Middle East in particular who has been kidnapped, trafficked, tortured. Their family members may be dead. They may be tortured. They may be trafficked as well. They might not have a clue what happened to them. They may be divorced, multiple times over a weekend, and they might have multiple different husbands that they've been sexually assaulted by just in a weekend. And they can be there for months, they can be there for years, sometimes it's just a weekend, but they will be married, raped, divorced, married, raped, divorced, sold, multiple times just in a short span when they're in this one sect, and then they might get sold to another sect where they do it again. That's a trafficking victim that's very difficult to stabilize. But the prostitutes, what about them? It's really quite the same. Now, we're not dealing with the marriage and the divorce issue, which certainly has its own religious connotations, particularly in Iraq with the Yazidis, who are a tribal group. But you're still having a victim that is going through, forced to go through multiple Johns, having sex multiple times a day, sometimes hit their quotas before they're able to eat that day. They might have quotas before they're able to sleep, take a break. They might have to make so much money by the end of the day or by the end of the week. And if they don't, they don't get to eat and they don't get to sleep. And they might make their money quota, but then they have to post themselves online on porn sites to get more customers, and they have a quota to meet that too right after they get off of work. And if they don't hit that quota, they don't eat, they don't sleep, they don't get their medicine, they don't get to see their kids, you name it. So how do you stabilize that? How many of you work with prostitutes in particular that you know of? Okay. We have discovered in private practice that if you don't directly ask the question, they're not always going to tell you. And it might have been from years ago, or they might not really realize that it was a form of prostitution. But oftentimes, if you learn how to interview them in a trauma-informed manner, and you're not scared to ask these questions, you're not going to offend them by asking. But you're going to miss a lot if you don't.
What you also might find is that you may find somebody who's been exploited in the sex industry. How many of you have clients who have been dancers? More of you, correct? Yeah. That's why we include this as part of this, because there are so many parallels to how being exploited for money affects the individual psyche and ends up showing up. And what you may end up finding as you go through this process or as you talk to your clients is that they have been trafficking victims and didn't realize it because it came as either a progression or a part of their entrance into the industry by dancing or whatever. You know, so they may not even conceive of themselves as victims of that. So.
Excuse me. So, why educate professionals? Well, you're encountering them in your work and you don't know it. You're encountering them and you do know it and you don't have the services to help them. You don't have the staff support. You don't have the cultural attitude to help you. You don't know what to do with compassion fatigue or your secondary trauma after you hear one story, much less you've worked with it for years. You don't know what to do with the burnout that goes with the bureaucracy and the tape, the red tape and all of the problems with funding and things that you're encountering. What do you do when you just hurt for that victim? And you might have the most appropriate internal emotional boundaries as a service care provider. Until you see that one person that comes in and breaks your heart, and then you go home and you're really messed up for a few days. But your family members don't understand why you're down. It's just work. Or we need you here at home. Or they're not your family. Or what do you do with all of the internal stuff that you're taking in? We're going to talk about that on day three also. Also, the more that professionals are educated, the more we get services, the more we change cultural attitudes, the more we're able to help affect the supply and the demand, the more we really truly start targeting the abusers instead of targeting the victims as the offenders as well. So changing a cultural attitude is the key to doing this. That's why we spend so much on day one just talking about the cultural attitude about this. And you have this in your handout, so we're gonna speed through this. So who needs training? You name it. If you have a pulse, you need training. And we're thankful that, honestly, we are thankful that you guys are here and those of you that are web-based. Robert Roten, was a couple years ago, a year and a half ago, contacted us and asked us if we would build a training on sex trafficking for professionals because there isn't one. And he's right, there isn't one. I was looking for ourselves. There isn't one. And when we started doing the research to write this, I can tell you there isn't one. There is training for law enforcement, which is fantastic. It's very basic. There is training for the medical field. It's very good, very basic. There's a little bit for attorneys. Very basic, mostly on how to prosecute. None for mental health. None that I have found, and I have searched high and low. There's a lot for trauma, lots of information on trauma, fantastic information on trauma, but nothing for trafficking. Fantastic information on trauma-informed care models, fantastic, nothing for trafficking. They're specific. And you guys know that we're dealing with trauma clients, a trauma culture, a family system that has also been traumatized with secondary trauma that has its own unique factors when we're talking about trafficking victims that nobody else understands. So even if you do come from a trauma-informed care or TIC perspective, and you're looking at it from a neurophysiology perspective, but you don't understand trafficking in particular, you're still very limited. And even this is just a 3-day training. We could do this every day for an entire year and still not cover all of the dynamics. But when Robert asked us to build this training, it was such a fantastic opportunity just to start changing the dominant discourse and the attitudes and start trying to make impact on this and get you guys some resources. Are you guys tired? Mm-hmm. Yeah, how many of you have done this for more than 5 years? But more than 10 years, 15, 20, see, I know, I see you, I feel you, I can feel it on you, I know, it's exhausting, you know. Who are your colleagues you staff this with? You know, how about the conferences you go to, look at the research and the training and the handouts and the workbooks and what are you supposed to do about treatment protocol? How about protocol for organizations? You know, there are three resources that are pretty good that I've got in the handouts, but one of them is for veterans. Fantastic. They're not trauma victims. It's a trauma program, which is great to be modified, but it's not for trafficking. It's insane. So part of your struggle, and what I encourage you to do, is start building trauma programs specifically for trafficking victims. Get some research, get some funding, and let's do something about this. All right, exploring the problem. We won't go through the types of trafficking too much because you're really here for sex trafficking and we just don't have enough time allotted. But these are the basic types of trafficking. And again, if you look at sex trafficking, they will fit in a number of these categories as well. Forced marriage, sex trafficking, you've got forced labor, debt bondage, domestic servitude, forced child labor, child sex trafficking, child soldiering, and organ harvesting. The only one that doesn't have sex trafficking involved directly is organ harvesting. It's its own little dip, but you will have sex trafficking victims that end up being organ harvesting. It's not happening at the same time. But how are we going to know? Because oftentimes the organ harvesting victims don't survive. Sometimes they do. You know, there's cultures of people that knowingly sell organs to support their families. It's a very common thing to do in their culture. And even though it's common, it's still trafficking. Who wants to sell their liver? You know, who wants to have to do that? Oh, okay, well, yeah, this neighborhood, they have one kidney. Well, like, yeah, it's all, everybody does it. Join the party. It's trafficking. But many of them die. And they can't tell us what happens. And the traffickers don't really care. They're just body parts. Okay, so again, you've got highlighted in red are some of the terminologies that you're going to want to know for the laws in the prosecution. High risk factors. So this is what we know typically of the current research, and again, it's limited, and this is not including the new movement into suburbia, into the affluent neighborhoods. But typically, you've got lower socioeconomic status. You've got runaways. By the time a kiddo, you guys might know this statistic by now, it's beginning to be a pretty common statistic. Once a runaway kiddo hits the streets, they're approached by a trafficker within 48 hours in America, the inner city kids. 48 hours on average. Why? Because you've got the traffickers that are looking for them. They're surveying the streets. They're looking for the fresh meat. And it's really easy to know a kid that just ran away. They don't have street cred yet. They look like it. They're behaving like that. They're scared. They're not that dirty yet. They don't really have the mannerisms of somebody that's been on the street. And that trafficker will know that vulnerability. They are master manipulators. And they are masters in psychology on how to size somebody up and profile them and look at their vulnerabilities. They'll go approach them. Hey, are you hungry? Hey, you need a place to sleep? Hey, I've got it for you. They start the grooming process. They start the trauma bonding. They're going to end up tricking that kid out. Foster children, kids in the juvenile justice system, kids with abuse histories, they're going to be vulnerable. They ran away from home. They might be highly sexualized. They might have bonding and attachment issues. We're going to go into that on day three. They need love. They need a family. They look for a place to stay. They're incredibly emotionally dependent and needy, easy victims. And then LGBTQ, they are grossly misrepresented in research, underidentified in trafficking, but we're starting to figure it out. Highest factors, drugs and alcohol, mental illness, physical illness, brain damage. MHMR cases, anybody that might need medication or health issues, conflict zones, war zones, that's easy to see, and people that have been smuggled. Those that have been smuggled, even though it's different than trafficking, they are very high risk for being trafficked, because once they are at their destination, oftentimes they're dumped. They have nowhere to go. If they lose the job they came to that country for, they've got no home, they've got no funding, they've got no resources, they don't know anybody. A lot of times they don't know the language. Easy for traffickers. So you'll have a lot of traffickers that are connected to the smugglers. And there's a huge underground network there. So barriers to eradication. What keeps us from being able to stop trafficking? Underground networks is all illegal. We're going to talk about the black market today, I think. The traffickers make a ton of money, and they're able to use their resources to avoid being prosecuted. We're going to skip through some of this and keep it in your handouts. Internationally, we have trouble with the cultural values, the religious ramifications, and with laws that will prosecute them and resources. Many victims don't even realize that they are victims, or they're afraid to report. Less than 1% are ever rescued. That's a global statistic, but it's a pretty consistent statistic when you're looking.
Can I make a comment there? This is the reason why you don't see them in your practices. Well, when I was making that comment and asking how many of you have seen a victim, there aren't going to be very many of you that are going to tell me that you've got a constant flow of victims coming through, because there aren't very many that survive. You know, especially if you're talking not the American version of prostitution and trafficking, but on an international scale.
That's true. And through this training, you'll be able to identify the ones that you never would have even imagined it. I have a client that I'm working with for reasons completely unrelated. He's an affluent guy, highly successful in the DFW area, highly educated. Typical corporate white collar guy. And in his treatment, probably worked with him about a year and a half. We were working on some sexual abuse history that he had. And as we're teasing through his sex history, starting to do some EMDR on his abuse, the guy was trafficked when he was in high school as an exchange student in Germany. And had I not known this information, I wouldn't have been able to Q&A him gently in a TIC fashion that we'll go through. Not just hammer him and freak him out, but I was able to be very compassionate and gentle in my questioning. I knew what to ask. Not just because I work with offenders, but I know the trafficking world as well. And when he went overseas to Germany to be an exchange student, he started being trafficked out by the house mom. That was the primary source of his sexual abuse for many years to come. He had no idea he was trafficked. I explained to him trafficking. It took a while for him to realize that he actually was trafficked. Academically, he understood it, but for them to internalize it and identify it rocks their world. It's different than I'm a sexual abuse victim that Oprah Winfrey hugs me for, you know? But when you're a trafficking victim and you are a high-level corporate exec in the DFW area, white boy, who are you going to tell? Who's going to understand? There's the stigma attached is insane. But by the second session, he was owning it. And now he's an advocate in his area, in his big giant company. But these are the kinds of things that are right under our noses that we don't even know. Gone through some of this already. Okay, so how do we eradicate? Everyone in here is an abolitionist. Did you know you're an abolitionist? You are. Okay, so different kinds of approaches. Prevention, prosecution, protection, and partnership. Prevention has to start with community education.